Oh, hello everyone. Good morning, US. Good afternoon, Europe. And good evening, India. This is really welcome in my webinar, in our webinar. This is really the exciting sunny side of this this COVID crisis, this lockdown situation, that we can literally reach out to people all over the globe. And we have so many different countries now in the room. I'm really excited, and I'm really happy to welcome you on this webinar, which I do together with my co-host Hester Jong, whom I will present you later. This webinar is about the sign of the times. How is this affecting consumer behavior, and what opportunities are there to set or reset your customer focus? But as I told you, I'm here together with Hester Jong, my business partner and friend, and she's always next to me, but now she's not next to me because she's in her own studio. Hester, are you there?
Hi, yes, I'm here, Christine. Hello, everyone. Great that you're here. Let me just take you through some very simple instructions. I can see that most of us watching are online. If not, I'll repeat something later, but some very simple instructions before Christine starts the presentation. This is a Webinar Geek that we are using, and it would be very practical if you run into any technical issues that you use the private chat, which is in Dutch called Openbare Chat, and it's on your right hand side in the screen. If you run into anything, you can just chat in there and I will try to help you. Nothing much happens usually, but sometimes there is a small hiccup that you can also help yourself by refreshing the page. That usually does the trick. Also, during the presentation, what Christine and I would like is to try and get some, well, not really interaction, but to get some questions from you to do a Q&A at the end of the presentation. So feel free during the presentation to send in any questions that you have concerning the content. Please, for that, use the private chat, which is a different one than the one you're using for the general issues. So don't be shy. Anything that comes along and you'd like to ask us, leave a message in the private chat and we'll collect them, or I'll collect them, and at the end we'll go through these and see if we can answer some of them. Then one more thing is that you can watch, as I'm sure you'll know, the presentation in full screen. There's an icon around somewhere around the screen that you can use for that. I'm not sure, but I don't think you'll have any trouble finding that. So, yeah, that's it for now. Just wishing you a very inspirational and good presentation. And back to Christine.
Thank you, Hester. I'm back again here. And let me start with my presentation. Or let me first introduce myself, because we have some new faces in the room, and not everybody knows who I am and what my way of working is. So my name is Christine Boland, and I work as a trend analyst and consultant. And I'm for 3 decades now studying the sign of the time and seeing how this is affecting consumer behavior and how you can anticipate on this consumer behavior. And by doing so, I help companies to navigate the future and to redefine their brand and to find their purpose. And to I do such things as well on a strategic level as well as on a more operational level, as you will see in this presentation later on. And then this title, I had this title, Reset Your Customer Focus. And in order to explain why I choose this title, I want to bring you along in my presentation, which is my analysis. I made it actually in the end of 2019 for this year and the years to come, an analysis on the sign of the times. And it's very interesting to see that some big trends, which are now very visible, were already there before the corona crisis. And what I will do now is that I take you along in my presentation named Being Human showing you how it was before the corona crisis and what is the effect of the corona crisis on these trends and where the opportunities are for you to reach your customer, to reset literally the focus on your customer. And what you see here is the title of the presentation is Being Human, and being human is a verb. It almost becomes a verb in this time frame where technological innovation and artificial intelligence are literally under our skin, and the boundaries between man and technology are blurring. And we see that what makes us human, there is where the opportunities lie. And what you see here is an image we made where you see a human, a multitasking human being in his filter bubble echo chamber, desperately seeking to get rooted in nature or whatever, being in a dynamic field of movement with other human beings, but also with voice automation, with the pressure of social media, with probably other networks gathering around him. And as you can see, there's this layer of corona, which is on top of this image. So that's where we are now. And in this challenging time frame, you see the world, the word principles of progress. That's the word I use for consumer trends. So principles of progress, what do you need to thrive in a world which is so challenging as you see on this image? So there are actually three principles of progress. The first one is reclaim inner direction for a sense of self. The second, be embedded for a sense of place. And the third is hack the perspective for a sense of wonder. But before I start to zoom in on these consumer drivers, consumer behavior fields, I would like to zoom out and look what is happening in the world. And if I had only 1 minute to explain our time frame now, I would use the word VUCA. And VUCA stands for volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. And actually, that's the time where we're in is about volatility, about fluidity, about seamlessness, frictionlessness. And I like to zoom in on this topic of seamlessness a little bit, because what we see is that the blurring boundaries literally between man and technology. Here's some examples. For instance, the book Machines Like Me from Ian McEwan is about a relationship of a couple with a robot and all the complications coming with that. And in the middle, on top, you see the first human cyborg. We met him in Cape Town at the Design Indaba conference, and he cannot see colors, colorblind, and he had an implant, an antenna implanted in his brain, so now he can feel the colors. So he's not colorblind by his eyes any longer, because he feels through this device what colors he sees. And then on top right, you see a Buddha who's literally preaching to millions of people at the same time. And on the bottom left, you see the commercial of Calvin Klein, where Bella Hadid is meeting up with Lil Miquela, who is a computer-generated person. So she's not real. And this is literally where we see where, the real and the virtual world are blurring together. And on the right side is a very emotional thing. This woman is wearing a virtual reality glasses, and she is seeing literally her child, which has passed away four years ago. So by artificial intelligence, they made this child grow up and talk to her mom. And the mama was very pleased with it. So, well, we can think a lot about it, but this is what is happening. I'm showing you this blurring fields, this mixed realities, this fluid world. And there are also many opportunities in this fluid world, because what we see is that, for instance, in games is happening a lot with brands who are teaming up with games like here Adidas and Fortnite. So, and on the bottom left, you see Carlings, which is a company who is making digital fashion. So these clothes are not made, but they are photoshopped on the image you send to them. And you pay like $30, and then they photoshop any item you like from their collection there is a limited edition. And then you can use this on your social media. So these clothes are never made, but it's huge business. And on the right side, we see the Fabricant, which is a platform where you can do a digital catwalk. So many designers and brands are now doing digital, online, virtual catwalk shows. And Squatted is a system, what you see here, that friends can go shop together online. So it's like a shopping party online, seeing diverse brands coming together with your friends. So this whole situation now is speeding up because we are literally get used to being on screens, but now we can meet on screen, we can shop together, we can make our own avatar, like on the top right with Yuke's. So you can literally fit the and try the clothes as you see in the stores. So yes, the world is the boundaries are blurring, and it's not only between analog and virtual. It's only also between genders or between true and false. For instance, this is a commercial, or actually it's the world news, but it's done by a robot or a computer generated entity, and it is by Balenciaga, and it's all not really real news. So this is surely a commercial, but it's becoming more and more difficult to really figure out what is true and what is false, and what is fake and what is real. So that is becoming a very important thing, that also the idea, who can I trust? Who is telling me what, and how do I know it's true? So I come back to that later in my presentation, because there's a very important point. But let's first look what, for instance, Dior did during the COVID-19 crisis. They opened literally their real store virtually. So you can go in and you say, okay, I want to go to the Bath & Bath. And then I choose one, and then I click, and then I can purchase it. And even now there is technology who can make you smell what you see, and who can make you feel what you touch. So there is happening a lot in this fourth space where retail is booming and blooming. And also not only Dior, but what about this cheese store, which literally went virtually online, and you can go there and say to this guy who is in the store, I want to have that and that cheese so much, and they will send it to you, and it's sent to you directly. So blurring boundaries. And then the U from uncertain. Well, I think I do not have to explain that one from the VUCA, because the world has almost never been more uncertain than it is nowadays. And we do not have any grip on what's happening around us. And no one dares to forecast what will happen in a week or in 2 weeks. So even New York Times is saying no one knows what's going to happen. What is interesting to tell is that before the COVID crisis, when I did my presentations for audiences, I always started to say, well, thank you very much. I'm invited here to take you through the sign of the times and to shine a light on the future and the things to come. And if you ask me what will happen in the future, then my answer will be, I have no idea. And then the whole audience is like, okay, but you're here to tell us. And I think the only good answer is that we don't have any idea, but we do know a lot. We do know the surrounding factors. We do know where we want to go. We do know the technological development. So it's more about connecting dots we know than exactly knowing what will happen tomorrow. So that will implicate that there are more probable futures, and we have to choose one for ourselves. So yes, uncertainty. And also the complex factor of this world is that things are going exponentially. For instance, only the Internet of Things is growing so exponentially that we, with our brain, we are not able to keep up with the pace of the technological developments and the implications. So we literally cannot understand what will happen tomorrow. And every day we will see new platforms, new ideas, new possibilities. So keeping up with this pace is complex and challenging. And then ambiguous. And ambiguous is literally meaning having two faces, two sides which are true both. And what we see is, for instance, this image in the middle is literally what's happening. Well, actually, a few weeks ago, that this was only 3 weeks in between these two situations. So you see that the pandemic situation is literally putting the world on its head, upside down. But even before the COVID crisis, and I keep on saying it because many people tend to think everything is because of the crisis. That's not true. The crisis is literally the catalyst for things which were happening already. So what we see here is that on the one hand, the paradoxical time frame was defined by the fact that on the one hand, everything is fluid and unlimited, but at the same time, just read the newspapers and you see there's things are rigid and restricted, and there are presidents who want to put a fence or a wall around their country, and we have polarization, and we think in black and white, and them and us, and et cetera, et cetera. And we are connected more than ever, and we felt connected less than ever. And that was before the COVID crisis. And now, during the crisis, this is turned upside down because we could not be connected because of the lockdown situation, and we felt so very connected. So that's interesting. And then what we see is an increasing wealth, but a decreasing feeling of well-being. So the economic situation in many countries is before the crisis was very good, but we do not feel happy. So that's why countries are now looking for not only the GDP, but also for a gross domestic well-being. And we see that everything was data-driven. So we could literally research everything, but we have never been more uncertain than now. And we see that there, thanks to technology, we can have extreme efficiency, but we have a time scarcity, which is at an all-time high. And we ask of ourselves and of companies, of brands, we ask stolidity, which means that you are strong and consistent, but at the same time, flexibility. So I always say as a brand or as a company, or even as a person or as a designer, you have to be like an octopus. You have to have this strong body with all your arms. You have to be there where your consumer, where your customer is, and then be relevant in the context of your customer. And then you could say the time frame we are in is frightening. Just look around what's happening and whoa, things are going so fast. But it's also so exciting because you name it and we can develop it. The technological possibilities together with human creativity literally makes that the sky is no longer the limit. So yeah, now during the crisis, it's not so exciting, but it will be exciting again, I'm sure. And then the paradigm shift. This is also, these are literally shifts which were already there for more years. And some are speeding up and some are only beginning. But what we see here is that also the crisis is like a catalyst. For instance, we see a shift that our biosphere is more and more becoming a technosphere. So we have to literally share our world with technology. And we see a very, very important shift, which is from marketing to consumers to mattering to people. People are longing for meaning and significance and want companies not only to think about growth, but about the impact they have on next generations, on Earth, on nature. And we see a shift from looking good to feeling good. And it seems like a very small difference, but it's $1 million business, I can tell you. And it's literally from outside in towards inside out. How do I feel? What do I eat? How do I do my exercises? Am I healthy? Health is the new handbag, we could read on the business of fashion. And you also see it now that there is a shift in popularity of influencers, those who are only showing their wealth and talking about the latest handbag. They are really losing many, many followers, whereas those who share their thoughts and who share their doubts and who are more human, they gain followers. So we see also a shift, especially for millennials and Gen Z, is a shift from owning to access, to sharing. And a shift from, which is very important, from business to consumer, to consumer to consumer. All these platforms, all these peer-to-peer selling, all this, especially in the fashion business, this is a huge shift. And the second-hand market is growing 21 times faster than the new fashion market. And we see a shift, and yeah, unfortunately we found out nowadays, the last 2 weeks, that we are far from there, but there is a movement from exclusion to inclusivity to equality. And although the world news now is literally showing us the contrary, also the huge reaction you see worldwide says that we are literally heading towards a more inclusive and a more equal approach of us as human beings. And what do we have as human beings? What are our archetypal human characteristics and skills? Well, that's actually what is the difference between artificial intelligence and robotics technology and human beings. Then we have quite an interesting list, because we have empathy and altruism. We have creativity, which is literally the fuel for the future. We have fantasy and imagination, and we can dream and we can play. We have rebellion. All these kind of things we cannot ask from artificial intelligence, because that's programmed. These are algorithms, they are programmed. And we have history and tradition, and we have spirituality, and we want stories, and we want meaning, and we want connection. And these are all human skills and human needs, actually basic human needs and human characteristics. And in innovation and in trends, you see that these are the underlying drivers. Somewhere you have to tick one of these boxes in your concepts. So that made me define these three principles of progress. The reclaim inner direction, which is literally about reclaiming my own space from this technosphere, making literally space for yourself. And we all know this feeling that you are searching for a holiday in Switzerland, and the next minute you get hiking shoes and outdoor gear in all your other search screens. So sometimes you get answers to questions you didn't even ask yet. And that can be, well, sometimes you can literally want to make the feeling, give me my own space, please. And that's reclaim inner direction, and also direction in the sense of being a director of your own life. And so as a brand or as an organization, you can figure out together what can we do to empower our customer for his or her sense of self, for his inner space, for his own direction. And the second one, be embedded, is about, I'll come to that, back to that later, because I have a lot of images to show you, but shortly now, being embedded, it's literally an imperative that we have to refine our place in ecosystems, not being only nature, but also the ecosystem, which is the technosphere, or the ecosystems within Team Human. What is the chain in which I'm operating, and what is my responsibility, and to whom am I connected? These questions we will answer in Be Embedded. And then Hack the Perspective, that is all about turning things upside down, find a new perspective, create surprise, because what happens to surprise if artificial intelligence is literally doing anything even before I have asked it? So that's an interesting field to research. Now let's have a look. What you see here is a collage, a mood board, a summary of Reclaim in a Direction before, as it was before the crisis. Just to show you that all these moods and these drivers were there already. It was all about lightening the load and finding, well, to rebalance and to recharge your battery to keep up the pace of the world around us. And it is about mood management. How can I help my customer to feel good in his or her situation? And so it's also about hyper personalization and hyper personalized marketing and targeting. So, and what I think, what you see here is some examples of this in terms of design language. For instance, the furniture on the downside left, these kind of designs we see a lot in interior design. It's clear that these persons, they want to be on their own for a second. And also we have this huge Dutch executive search organization, Ebbingen, who is saying, the real leaders are, in essence, are really connected to their inner self. Or the international commercial of SIF, which is YIF in Dutch, tidy house, tidy mind. So now you see here that the marketeers there really understood how to reach the consumer. What is top of mind of this moment? And also the graffiti up there, nothing impressed no one, that we don't want this pressure of full-time being connected and online and showing and being, well, whatever we need to be in this time frame. And then this yellow sweater is interesting because that is not so true any longer, because on this sweater is written, cancelled plans are my favorite plans. And I think we can say that this is one of the things that during the crisis literally faded away. But on the right-hand side below, you see Selfridges, who enabled customers to peel potatoes, to unwind and to slow down on their very, very precious square meters on Oxford Circus. You could go in the basement and just peel potatoes. So these are some signals that we that companies and marketeers and products and services were aiming for this Reclaim in a Direction sense of self trend. And let's now look what happened when the crisis, what the Corona crisis, how it affected this trend, this principle of progress. Well, this is quite literally what I meant, but then not so literally as it is here with a circle around you. But the idea of literally owning, claiming a bubble for yourself where you can, when nobody can reach you and when you are safe from any information and things like that. Well, now we are literally are dealing with it. And what is interesting, there has been published a very interesting research by Sonoma in the Netherlands. I will translate it for you, but I wanted to show it to you, although it's Dutch. What were the first things people started to do as of the moment of the lockdown? Well, surely wash our hands, surely. But then cleaning the houses, downshifting, arranging, looking around in your own house, what do I want to keep and what can I miss and what do I have? It's all about reflection and cleaning up. And the third one is also about fixing things in your house and painting. And that's why the DIY stores, they have all-time high turnover at the moment. And then going out for a walk, at least in the Netherlands, we were allowed to go out and have a walk. Or playing games together. So you see that the behavior is changing, and that's interesting because we've been now in the situation for like 14 weeks. And also in the same, in the follow-up of the research, many consumers think that they want to keep up with this lower pace they had during the crisis. And who would ever have thought that one of the major important Dutch newspapers would have a whole spread just telling about how you could clean properly your windows. That's what happened in the Corona time. And here, what we also see is that staying healthy was top of mind for everyone. Well, that's not so. You don't have to be a futurist to understand that. But what you saw is that all the yoga teachers and all the meditation teachers, they went immediately online. And, well, as well did my yoga teacher. And I've never done so many yoga classes a week as the last 12 weeks. And, well, that's wonderful. I don't have to go anywhere. It's just in my house. And what I like very much is what we see here is the quote of Prince Iya. So the shift towards this inner peace and finding balance, and happiness is the new rich, and kindness is the new cool, and health is the new wealth, and inner peace is the new success. This is an interesting phrase. And if this is what we feel, what does that mean for your business? What can you do with this? And there are many, like the 360 magazine articles saying, let's take this moment that we now all have paused, all have this idea of a new beginning, probably after the crisis. Let's take this opportunity to do the things totally different. And although I know it's for many people very, very overwhelming, a good advice can be is that you focus on things you can control and things that matter. So the things you, because there's so much we cannot control. We know, because now we know that we cannot control everything in the world. That is one of the conclusions, the painful conclusions of nowadays. So focus on what you can control. That is for you as a person, but also for you as a brand, as a business and as an organization. And it's interesting to find out what are the things which we can control, and how can we then use these three principles of progress to be our guide. And also what we saw during the lockdown situation is that although we also were asked to do so, support your locals, that many customers and consumers literally went to the local farmers and try to rediscover their local small stores. And I think this is for a trend which was there already for a longer time, is a very a very strong catalyst effect. So the more local, the better. And we can literally question ourselves, do we have to transport all these goods over the globe when we have it so close by? So for so far, the reclaim inner direction. Let's have a look. What does be embedded implicate? Well, here you see some examples of being embedded in like team human, which I mentioned before. How are we relating to other people? Can we help each other? We as human beings are very social creatures, and we always are searching for connection. And but due to the whole filter bubble world we are living in, sometimes we feel disconnected to those we don't see in our echo chamber. So it's really time to reach out and to be aware of that. And a nice example you see in the bottom left, that is from a Dutch supermarket, Jumbo. It's one of the biggest in the Netherlands. And I work with them, and their CCO, who I am consulting, she said to me, I want to be, especially in summer holidays, I want to be there for these lonely elderly people of whom the kids are on holiday and they are lonely. And how can we help them? And then we thought, why literally flip the system and not make a very efficient cashier counter, but make the slowest one there is? So we opened, which is in Dutch, the Kletskassa, and in English, it's the chat counter. And there you can take like 50 minutes to talk and to chat and to tell what you bought and to tell, what you want to share with this nice girl who's behind this this counter. And for sure, this is not immediately generating turnover in probably in euros, but they had such a huge success with this, because it was in America, it was on the news. In Belgium, it was on a television show, a word which people had to guess what it means. In the Netherlands, it was chosen word of the year by another big Dutch newspaper. So now they already have 33 of these chat counters. And after the corona crisis, of course, they will roll out more of these ones. So being being relevant in the context of your customer here is a very strong example of seeking connections, being embedded in Team Human. And on the top in the middle, you see Next Nature, which is a very interesting book by Koert van Mensvoort about explaining us how we can find our, as humanity, our place in the superorganism, which is the technosphere. And he says technospheres are next nature, so we better adapt. And top left is an exhibition which we had in Tropenmuseum here in Amsterdam, named What a Genderful World. And top right is a very interesting video of BBC about the wood wide web, explaining us that the trees and the plants are literally under our feet, connecting to each other, helping each other, communicating, warning each other, being a more wide web than we know, and we can learn a lot of that. And on the bottom right, we see technology in our lives. This is the Vitality Coach car of Mercedes, telling you when your heartbeat is too low or too high, or when you're almost sleeping, your dashboard is telling you that you have to take a break or to be aware of what's happening. So what we see in this Be Embedded is that I had another example, which I mentioned already, that being embedded in technology. Now here you see the augmented touch. What I mentioned before is that you literally can touch what you see on your screen. So that's next level of being embedded in technology. Well, this need of human beings to be connected was bombarded at the moment that the crisis started, that the lockdown started. We could not leave our houses. Everyone was reaching out to each other. Everyone was sharing their songs and their thoughts and their appreciation for the health workers from their balcony. And we have never been more connected as human beings and as in the beginning, especially of the lockdown situation. And it was also very democratizing to whom you can reach out, because everyone was open to join and to make music together and to help each other. And it was also interesting to see that this huge appreciation for the vital workers. So not only in the hospitals, but also the cleaners and the people working in the supermarkets. And what you see here is interesting, that these street artists are expressing their thoughts on how important these people are. And you see this Banksy design, where this little child is preferring a nurse above Superman and Batman. And he gave literally this piece of art to the hospital in Southampton, so they will have a lot of money in the coming time. But also, who would have said that ever the glossies would now focus on new frontline important persons? So here we see a very important shift also from only beautiful to a more meaningful and significant. And we saw another interesting phenomena, which is an app that was created for those who felt alone. You can join this app and you can just call. And then you get, your call is answered by somebody somewhere in the world. And you can just chat and say, hello, I'm alone. Yeah, I'm alone too. And then you have a chat together. And there are beautiful stories told on this app, how people met each other and chatted with each other. And another interesting thing marketing-wise is this football league, which also had to lock down. They gave a list of 30 very, very old and good and loved fans. And they said to their players, you just go and call these fans and ask how they're doing and tell them that we are missing them. So this is one of the best things you could have done and still can do during this lockdown and crisis situation is connect to your consumer. How is my consumer doing? How can I help him? What does he need or she? And so it's more about human to human, mattering to people, than marketing to consumers. And a good example on the political level is Jacinda Ardern. Jacinda Ardern, du moment that the crisis and the lockdown started, she every day started to chat with her people, with her inhabitants, explaining why the lockdown was there, because they were they were the first to lock down the whole country and the borders and et cetera, et cetera. And now they are the first to be over Corona. And she was literally saying, yeah, I'm sorry for my sweater, but I just had three toddlers which I had to bring to their beds. And now I talk to you and let's keep in touch. And if you have any question, you can ask me. So her, population rate went sky high. But also here in the Netherlands, just normal guys who said, okay, let's make a platform. It's translated normal, ordinary people helping other ordinary people, human to human. And they build a platform that, for instance, I am living in Amsterdam and my mother-in-law is living in Breda, which is a 1 hour drive, and she's on her own. And I can ask in this platform, is there anybody who wants to drink a cup of coffee with her or who can do some shopping for her? And then somebody in Breda could answer, oh yes, I can do it. And so all was arranged via this platform. And if you dive in the platform, it's heartwarming what you see, what people are doing for each other, and so many questions which are resolved by people who volunteered. And also on our Queen's Day, the students of Only Groningen went to elderly homes and gave them a very specific Dutch tompoes, which is a Dutch nice, sweet cookie. Well, and they went to all these individuals and said, have a nice Queen's Day. And unfortunately, you cannot go out, but we do not forget you. And now on a more commercial level, which is very interesting, which has never happened before, is that all the DIY stores or the hardware stores, that, like the Home Depot in America, they work together in one commercial, saying we will get here through this crisis together, and we can help you. We are here for you. But they, all the competitors in one commercial, or Coca-Cola saying we are in this together. And du moment, as of the moment of the lockdown, they reserved their total marketing budget, which was 120 million euros. To help the health workers and to help save and fight the crisis and help the health workers for whatever they need. And another interesting example, there are many, but this one is a strong one. We know that many brands have made hand alcohol and mouth protection gear and things like that. But what is interesting of this Bavaria example is what they did is that immediately after the restaurants and bars had to close, actually the day after, they went to all their clients, Bavaria, the beer provider, and they went to all the clients and they took back what they sold already. So all these small bars and restaurants, they could give back their beer, etc., to Bavaria, and then they made hand alcohol of it. And what is interesting is this is a good example of taking responsibility of your whole ecosystem. So not only the product and the customer, but also who is more in the chain, who is making it, where do the resource coming from? And here they really took responsibility for the whole ecosystem. A very good example. And talking about ecosystems, we also saw nature recovering. Yeah, we've all seen these images. And then, for instance, in India, there is a place where they have had not seen the Himalaya for like 30 years, and now they can see it. And so the higher atmosphere has cleaned up, and we have harvested solar energy at an all-time high, and the carbon dioxide was at a lowest level since 2008. So it really, well, confronts us in a painful way that our behavior, our flight movements, our movements across the globe literally take too much. And if we give the atmosphere only 1 month, everything changes. So let's keep on going, being more aware of this. And then I want to share an image of you from a friend of mine in India who sent me this. Just after that, there was in the newspapers that the Himalaya was visible. This guy took an image on his balcony saying, "Oh, I'm so happy that finally the sky is clear and I can see the rest of the world again." And we see here nature taking over, all these parks which are closed, and the animals are, well, taking over nature. And as I mentioned, this wood wide web, nature recovering, and also the connection to nature was a mega trend, I can say. And we see, for instance, in urban planning and architecture and in design, we see that we literally try to rebalance with nature and to bring nature back in our daily lives and in our retail environments. For instance, here, the new IKEA store to be built in Vienna, which is planted with a lot of trees and no cars. And there's retail space, there's experience space. So it's literally a concept store of the times to come. And also on fashion trends, these are quite extreme examples and interior trends, but everything with leaf and green and flowers is literally, overwhelmingly present. And this is also an interesting trend about reconnection to nature. It's called pavement chalking, botanical pavement chalking. And it's a trend in France and in England and in and as well as in the Netherlands and spreading the globe. And it's as simple as that people just showing us the small plants in our urban environment. And there's a diversity which is actually bigger than the amount of diversity people, for instance, in Amsterdam. So being aware of what around us, reconnect to nature, learn from nature, from the ecosystems, that's what it's all about. And then the third one, hacking the perspective. That's literally, it's in Dutch, het systeem op zijn kop, was in my presentation. And it's, well, I could not imagine that became so true. It's literally the system flipped. But we saw already that brands were playing with flipping the system, like Lensfeld going to Milan saying we have nothing new, or Mudjeans on Black Friday turning it blue and making all the jeans $10 or euro more expensive, and then every single item they sold they gave the money to a good cause. So it's which perspective do you choose? And also the image in the middle, I really love it. I think this is for everyone a nice hacked perspective. It depends on what side you're on, and try to, well, to see it from the other side and then create wonderment. And well, this is also the theme where everything is about creativity. And I could say the good news of the whole situation now is that when the sign of the time becomes difficult and restricted like it has been, human creativity is exploding. And that's literally what is happening now. For instance, this is a good example. That's a Dutch girl who was living in a small room somewhere, three on the third floor in Amsterdam with her kids, and she could not go out. And then she said to herself, "Okay, let's take an historic painting, and I'm gonna reproduce this painting and put it online." And then suddenly this went viral, and the rules were that you could use only three props from your house, and then you have to choose a historic painting and then try to make it. And if you go on this Instagram account, which is now worldwide, it's in Dutch is Tussen Kunst en Quarantaine, but also the Metropolitan is following her. It's really interesting, but also how creative people are and how we are literally inspiring each other, and how also youngsters, for instance, who, like in this example, the high fashion Twitter group, who were looking forward to the Met Gala, which was cancelled, and they said, okay, let's do our own Met Gala. And these dresses you see here are created, are made of paper. And also, if you look at the hashtag HFT, you will see nice examples of this. And it's interesting because this diving into history and art history and theatrical fashion is going on in winter 21-22. I just finished my analysis for the season, on which I premiere on the 2nd of July. But I share some slides with you here. And then we see that this historic point of view, but then translated into a very modern way, is leading in not only the catwalks, but also in graphic design, in interior design, in makeup, in art, in the stage design, visual merchandising. So take a historic inspiration and transform it into an alien, modern, new translation. And even the crinoline dressing is coming back. And how about this example of Gucci? G-Star, together with the Dutch National Ballet. They had the social distance dress, social distance ballet. And about creativity, also Bonobos, they asked, looking good, feeling good, they asked their consumers to upload an image, and then their creatives will make a beautiful design of what you sent to them. And also the artists themselves are playing and rebelling. For instance, Banksy, again, he had to stay in the house as well. So he went on with his graffiti in his own house. Or this inventive idea of Nick Versant, a Dutch designer, together with Jolan van der Wiel, they have a concept for how we could translate social distancing in real life without wearing crinoline dresses. And we see very inventive new concepts, which are literally, COVID-proof. And another flip the system was here at the Conrad shop, where they thought, okay, if we have this social distancing, why not say, okay, no cars any longer. We take the two stairs for the cars. We paint them white, and we make a museum where consumers can come and on a distance and see all our new stuff. So it is literally reimagining retail. How can I adapt? How can I make my store so that it's worth to spend time there? Because that's the challenge for the future for any retailer, is many things we can get online. So why should I come to your store? Then I have to either meet interesting people, learn something, have an experience, memorable moments. So these are the things you have to ask yourself when you open or reopen your store. And here, creativity on a more serious level, that students within 3 weeks made an emergency ventilator working to help the intensive care departments, and also the diving masks, which can help to prevent even people to go to the intensive care. Or how about Nike, who flipped their own system? They for once don't do it. They have a commercial which is very impressive, which is in the Black Lives Matters movement and after the horrible situation in the world now. And they have only black screen saying, don't turn your back on racism, don't accept innocent lives being taken, don't make any excuses, don't think this doesn't affect you, don't sit back and be silent, don't think you can be part of the change, but you can. Just for once, just don't do it. So, and hacking the perspective, as I mentioned before, we could also see this crisis, after the crisis, as kind of clean slate and start over and change the system. And here you see many signals of, for instance, the fashion business, who really want to stop the turbulent calendar they have and go back to two collections a year and probably travel less. And Amsterdam is literally initiating to embrace the donut economy and to find a new balance of how many tourists do we accept in the future in our city, so that our citizens can still enjoy the city as well. So that's an interesting before and after situation. And in the same research, 76% of consumers, they say they think they are changed, and they will continuously change the behavior as it has been changed during this situation the last 3 months. We are not sure of that yet. It's too early to say, but it's good to know that we all, as human beings, as consumers, as your customers, as we all have experienced this period of restriction and of contemplation and of a lot of challenges and also fear, etc. And it changed us a little bit. And if that will sustain, we'll see. But many people say they think it will. So the conclusion is that the corona crisis is a catalyst for change, which already started long before, which was beginning, and some trends were bigger and on speed already. And to talk about the future is very difficult. We can talk about probable futures. We can talk about preferable futures. We know what it means being human. We know where the opportunities lie. We have these three principles of progress. So the best way to predict your future as well as mine is to create it yourself. And in order to do so, you can ask yourself the following questions. What are the implications of this time frame for my organization, for my consumer, for my marketplace, for the chain, for my ecosystem, or for the journey my customer is making? Is this still analog, or is it online, or is it both? And how can I reach my consumer? So you can, and with your brand, how can I on all these questions? I hope this will be all about, and this is literally my linking your purpose to the all world, finding the sign of the times. How can I be relevant to this situation? And show you, in the video, I wrote, it's a reader, it's a small book, but it contains the whole story on our website. Oh yes, there is this corona update. Left the before corona, and I had a with it. So you almost 1 hour. So there are there some questions we can.
Yeah. Hey, Christine. Here, I'm back. Yes, we've had some questions. And he's. Do you think more or less situation, or do you think it will all
good question and a very relevant question. And I think it's to this time frame long time a lower pace possibilities. Around me, and I read in articles and ways that people think they will, but we are have had this behavior before the crisis for so long. So I dare not to say we, but some things will absolutely change. Only the digital behavior that we are really used to. And then meet each other and wait for each other. Yeah, will absolutely go on going in possibilities and there. Yes, the consumer this is too early now. We cannot.
From Lise, that was in the beginning of your situation now, situation to come, biosphere here.
Yeah.
This shift is not balance between technology and the capacity.
And that's actually ahead. Moving from towards the technology, literally almost everything, and we find to relate to that. And also, the thing is that technology covers so not only nature relating to technology. Relating to nature and have this be embedded with three of us, team human, technology and nature. Balance. Having a hard time due to our behavior, due to technology, and technology can literally help us in the remaking Australia and helping to preserve biodiversity, precision farming. So technology relate to nature as well. Biosphere process technology. Into a technosphere, and we have sense
okay. Thank you for that. I hope Lise that answers your question. Until no brick shops exists, what is your view on that?
Brick shops please stay, and a bit already is the reason is about meeting, learning, caring. So the as one part of and do online, but the physical is very this time frame where we are heading towards a meaning and learning and store. We need the a brand to speak and to be part of human belonging and be part of something and yes, in the beginning, social distancing or distancing or cannot be so.
Okay, thank you, Christine. Effect of us people missing culture, missing museums, missing visiting, not already.
Yeah, that's it. And for which trends to come. Ready that this into art and history and every beautiful thing which has and is now coming back in one way renewed. It's that our fingers touch clothes, for instance, it's a lot of fabrics. Etc. So, culture, art, new exhibition. I think are open, reopened, and then you buy a time slot. I think in the end we exhibitions and yeah, theater is still big. They also are online. Yeah, I was at the Museum Voorland. New insight that you want to go to look online which time slot is available, you go, and so it's not, there's no and it's my time and I can stay for 2 hours and there's space enough. So yeah, there's also an opportunity the visitors and
that answers your question. For now, that's it, Christine. We'll round up.
Thank you. I told you, but thank you again all of being here and joining it in more language part because then I will take you on the whole journey through what is affecting design language. So please join and thank you so much for now. I hope to see you probably in real life and be back on the screen. with me.